You remember when the guys out at the Space Center sent up that special craft that probed Uranus? For 3 years, they were talking about probing Uranus. Well, I know a lot of you knew what they were doing and a lot of you didn't, but I'm Professor Joe Bob Briggs, and our course this week on Joe Bob Summer School involves all heavenly matters, and it's called UFO Studies 666. We'll be watching Mars Attacks, the Tim Burton all-star alien comedy, and the 1956 cult classic Forbidden Planet starring Leslie Nielsen, Robbie the Robot, and the gorgeous Anne Francis. I've had a crush on her all my life, and here she is on the show tonight. And our guest lecturer is physicist, author, and ufologist Stanton T. Friedman, who's bringing with him some very interesting data on flying saucers. First up, though, do you know your planets? And do you know Uranus? For example, what's the farthest planet from Earth, huh? What is it? You're cheating, and you're wrong. It's Neptune. Sometimes it's Pluto. But beginning in 1979, that wacky Pluto crossed over Neptune's orbit and got closer to the sun. Later this year, it's going to cross back over Neptune's orbit and once again become the last planet in the system. Pluto wasn't even seen until 1930. So when did Walt Disney first draw Pluto? In the 30s, right? He created Pluto right after we first saw Pluto. You don't find this in other courses. All right, let's run through the lineup. Girls know this stuff because they do astrology. But you guys, listen up, okay? Mercury. Why does it say Mercurius on our map? We have a Latin map here. All right, what do we know about Mercury? Airless and cratered, the acne planet, right? It's been zapped with so many asteroids it looks like Carl Malden's nose. But one day on Mercury is 58 Earth days. But that's not what blows my mind. There are only 1.5 days in a year on Mercury. I don't even know how to think about that. Okay, Venus. The Zsa Zsa Gabor planet. Wasn't Zsa Zsa the star of Queen of Outer Space? Wasn't that on Venus? It has a surface pressure that's 90 times that of Earth. So if you stood on that planet, you would just, like, disintegrate. You'd be crushed, unless you were protected by something stronger than any known substance, like Zsa Zsa's pancake makeup or something. It's all desert and acid clouds. The only thing it'd be good for would be, like, casinos. So, and on this planet, a day is longer than a year. See, this stuff really messes with you. All right, Earth, skip it, boring. Mars, the subject of tonight's movie. We always thought that this is where the aliens lived, right? So we sent that explorer thing up there and it crawled all over the place. Rocks and sand, that's it. Volcanoes, dunes. Remember how boring it all was? You know, we were interested in that for like 3 days, you know, and hey, it has a pink sky. That was the most interesting thing they could come up with. Mars is now known as the wallflower planet, okay? Jupiter, king of the planets, because it's the biggest one, the fastest one, goes around so fast there's only 10 hours in a day. But it's all hydrogen, helium stuff. It's like a big Molotov cocktail, bubbles up at the equator, bulging out all this liquid hydrogen, causing humongous storms. Weather report on Jupiter is like, here comes hurricane, remove all life forms, okay? Saturn, the pretty one, you know, because it has all the cute little rings. And you know what those things are? Ice particles, hydrogen, helium, same as Jupiter. Uranus, the famous Uranus. Voyager 2 got there in 1986, and we got to see it for the first time. Couldn't see it before that because it has this icy fog thing around it. And you know what we found out? It doesn't orbit around the sun. Kind of rolls around the sun sideways like a drunk, you know? 21 years of sun, 21 years of darkness. The longest winter on record. But I don't want to dwell on the dark side of Uranus, and neither do you. Neptune! Voyager 2 got there in 1989, found hydrogen, helium, some soft ice, basically one giant Slurpee there, just swirling around, almost colliding with Pluto, which is where we started. And I think, what would happen if little Pluto hit Neptune? It'd just go right through it, right? Because it's a Slurpee. Anyhow, let's start our first movie, Mars Attacks, the story of how the Joker, James Bond, Tom Jones, Foxy Brown, Ed Grimley, and Queen Amidala defend the Earth from little green men that quack like ducks while turning people into steaming green skeletons. And then at the first break, we'll have our special ufologist guest, Stanton T. Friedman. And that's it. Roll film. Okay, fire away. I can take it. Hit me with your best shot. You're going to reduce me to tears, aren't you? You're going to emasculate me with your mail, as usual. But if you got something to say about tonight's movie, or me, or the mail girl, or the war in Kosovo, then I invite you, because I am a masochist, to contact me at my personal email address, monstervision@turner.com, or you can visit the MonsterVision website at tnt.turner.com/monstervision and send a crushing, mean-spirited email from there. Or you can even do it the old-fashioned way by sending a letter to MonsterVision, care of TNT Programming, 1010 Techwood Drive, Atlanta, Georgia, 30318. So I've given you three ways to nuke me. I would remind you, God is watching what you write.
Visit the MonsterVision website at tnt.turner.com/monstervision. Back to Joe Bob Summer School and Mars Attacks on TNT.
Well, what can you say? It's got a good cast. Did I mention the Star Wars tie-in? That's Queen Amidala as the president's daughter. And I like Martin Short in this. I love when he plays the smarmy guys. I should point out that one of the gals he offered to date, if you know what I mean, was Jack Nicholson's real-life girlfriend, Rebecca Broussard. I didn't get too good a look at her, though, because I was preparing for our guest lecturer, who's just joined us. He has a master's degree in physics. He was a classmate of Carl Sagan, and he's written numerous articles as well as two books, including Crash at Corona, about the Roswell incident. Lectures all over the country, and we're happy to have him here. Ufologist Stanton T. Friedman. Welcome, Stan.
Glad to be here. Ufologist, like geologist and biologist.
Ufologist. Sorry, it's not ufologist. It's no. Ufologist. Okay. So, Stan, how many UFO sightings do you think are actually aliens? And not just some drunk guy with a good imagination. Well, give me numbers here.
Okay, right? If you take the largest study ever done for the Air Force, 21% of the 3,200 cases investigated turned out to be completely unexplainable, separate from the ones for which they didn't have enough data, which they were 10%. So it's a significant percentage. Sightings are common. I check all my audiences, more than 700, and at the end of the lecture, of course, never at the beginning. And I find that 10% of the people believe they've seen a flying saucer. But when I asked how many reported, it was only 10% of the 10%.
How many guys on the crew saw flying...
Here you go, right here.
Oh, no, this camera three saw a flying saucer. That's about 10%, you know. Well, do you think it's feasible for the government to keep these things secret, considering the dirt that leaks out of the White House these days?
Well, I worked on classified programs for 14 years, nuclear rockets and fusion rockets, nuclear power plants for space. And, of course, you can keep secrets. So the black budget... not under direct congressional control of the director of Central Intelligence, a court case it took to find this out was $26 billion.
But
secrets are easy to keep. The need to know concept is primary. It's not just having a clearance. I've been to 18 archives. We still haven't seen any above top secret stuff, top secret, ultra, umbra. They've got it. They'll admit to me that, oh, we got drawers full of this stuff, but you aren't going to see
it. Well, have you filched anything? Have you come up with any proof of...
I've come up with an enormous amount of evidence, not only that the planet's being visited by extraterrestrial spacecraft, that is some UFOs or alien spacecraft, but that we're dealing with a cosmic Watergate. Some few people in major government agencies have known since 1947.
Cosmic Watergate. 1947, Roswell, right?
Roswell.
You got anything on Roswell?
I've got loads.
Besides good barbecue, you can get that in Roswell.
There are some really good military people down there. They're dying. We're losing our witnesses, of course. We're racing the undertaker. But I began the civilian research on Roswell. My book, Crash at Corona, deals with that. And there's no question, if you look at the military people, the people out near the ranch, the people in Texas where the wreckage went, remember, we're talking about the only atomic bombing group in the entire world, the 509th, mm-hmm. which was the military group at Roswell. And we're also talking about the fact that most people don't seem to know that this story hit the headlines, but the news release didn't go out until noon New Mexico time, too late for all the morning newspapers in the country, New York Times, Washington Post, et cetera. The cover story came out at 5 o'clock Texas time. The only paper I know of, the Los Angeles Herald Express, has both stories. Army captures flying saucer. Headline, front page.
And the Los Angeles Herald Express no longer exists today.
See, they got punished.
I don't think so. Okay,
Most evening papers are gone.
Bunch more questions for you, Stan, but let's get back to the movie and we'll talk at the next break, okay? And I think, you know, those people, you said the wreckage fell in West Texas. Those people in West Texas, they're not fazed by anything, though. You know, alien wreckage.
in the yard.
There weren't many people around. It was a four-square-mile pasture. And I was down there a few months ago. We drove 57 miles without seeing another car.
I've done that many times, Stan. I'm from Texas.
This was in New Mexico.
Oh,
even
okay.
Less populated.
New Mexico. All right, same thing.
Rusty the Mail Girl here, inviting you to visit our Monster Vision website. This is the place to get the scoop on zombies, ghouls, road warriors, or whatever happens to be the late-breaking story on this week's show. Check out our Playmate of the Week, or try your luck at the Monster Vision Caption Contest and win a free T-shirt. Or visit Joe Bob's mailbag page, where you can see your favorite fan mail of the week. To find us on the internet, go to tnt.turner.com/monstervision. I'll be waiting.
Visit the Monster Vision website at tnt.turner.com/monstervision. Back to Joe Bob Summer School and Mars Attacks on TNT.
Annette Bening aligning her chakras. Yummy. I hope you guys watched Escape from the Planet of the Apes when we had it on a few weeks ago, because I think Tim Burton definitely must have seen that movie before he made this movie. The Jack Nicholson and the Pierce Brosnan characters in this movie are right out of that flick. This movie is actually based on the Mars Attacks bubblegum cards. This may be the only movie based on bubblegum cards, but who cares about that when Stanton T. Friedman is here, our guest ufologist.
Right on.
And I hear you've given testimony at congressional hearings, right? What kind of hearings were those?
Well, six scientists testified in person, six more of us in writing. Only the House Committee on Science and Astronautics, this is way back in 1968, and some outstanding work was presented. A professor of physics, I was the only one without a PhD in this group of people. Carl Sagan was there.
You never wrote that paper, did you?
Nope. I've written a lot of papers since, but no thesis. There are about 10 about UFOs, incidentally, but it takes a gutsy professor
people
to do
have
that.
Actually got degrees for writing a paper about UFOs?
Yeah, in history, in sociology, things like that. Journalism, one gutsy journalist wrote one saying how terrible the press coverage was of the subject. Still true. It was written a long time ago. But, congressional hearings didn't have much impact, but they did present a lot of data in one single volume, 250 pages. Anybody who wants really good cases, they're mm-hmm. in there because they are by scientists. Yeah.
Tell us about this Harry Truman operation that you say you've authenticated. What exactly was covered
up?
Well,
that's the whole subject of the book, of course.
Okay.
What was covered up was the establishment...
That book is...
Top Secret Magic. M-A-J-I-C. That's the security markings on the document.
With a foreword by Whitley Strieber. Now, why does it surprise me that he is also a ufologist?
Well, he wrote a book about his own abduction case,
right.
And he wrote a book about Majestic. This
we
is about Majestic.
We showed that very movie on this show. What's the name of the movie?
Communion.
Communion with Christopher Walken.
Yeah, it didn't last very long in most towns where it played, unfortunately.
I can see how you would think of Christopher Walken as your alter ego, Stan.
Not really.
Have you ever had a close encounter of the
I've never had any sighting. Look, I've never seen Tokyo. It's there. I've never seen a neutron or a gamma ray. I've been chasing them for 43 years.
But isn't that kind of disappointing that they wouldn't contact the guy who's their leading spokesman on the planet?
I don't think they're here to contact us. I think primarily they're here to keep us from going out there, where a primitive society whose major activity is tribal warfare. If you were an alien, maybe, if you were an alien, would you want Earthlings out there? This is a primitive society. Major activity is tribal warfare. We're probably the devil's
You're
island.
You're actually describing the plot of this movie. I'm going to ask you what you think about this movie that we're watching, but let's roll a little bit more of it, and then we'll come back to it. But
okay.
You think they are primitive and they are warlike.
No, we are primitive.
Oh.
They're here to make sure we primitives
they're trying
don't
to keep
go out
us
there.
From attacking
Quarantine.
Them. Okay. What exactly is the third kind? I sort of remember it from the Spielberg movie. Was that accurate?
Well, science it wasn't. Investigation
okay.
it wasn't. Close encounters of the first kind within 500 feet, of the second kind where they produce a physical effect, of the third kind where beings, strange or not, are seen. One guy's collected 5,000 cases of physical traces from 65 countries. Happens all over the place. About 1,000 of those cases involve reports of creatures, beings, call them aliens, call them what you want. Then there's the fourth kind when the people are taken on board, and the fifth kind when you say, hey, guys, come on down, and they come on down. That's a little hairy.
So, like, in Sex with Aliens, like, Definitely third kind. Right?
No, fourth kind.
Oh, fourth kind. Who even have a fourth kind? So you always have ladies saying, well, we had sex with the aliens.
Hey, there's a guy who was...
Oh, the guys have sex with the aliens, too? I don't want to hear about it, Stanton.
That's another movie.
Think you're funnier than Joe Bob? Who isn't, right? But can you prove it? Then enter the MonsterVision Caption Contest and try to make the six-headed jury laugh. And no, I'm not one of the heads. What do you win if you slay them with your caption? How about this incredibly collectible t-shirt? To play, go to tnt.turner.com/MonsterVision and look for the Caption Contest link. And may the best man, woman, or mutant win. Everyone's eligible. Oh, except Joe Bob. We've heard enough from him, don't you think?
Play the Monster Caption Contest and win a free t-shirt at tnt.turner.com/MonsterVision. Back to Joe Bob Summer School and Mars Attacks on TNT.
So, Stan, you have any evidence of aliens making the international sign of the donut?
No. Not at all.
Professor Joe Bob's still here with Stanton Friedman, who's our guest lecturer for Joe Bob Summer School, course 666, UFO Studies. Stan, what do you think of this movie, Mars Attacks? Did they get anything in this movie right?
They probably did. The special effects were great. I was greatly disappointed when I watched the movie, frankly. It seems to be based on a set of false assumptions, namely the only thing advanced technology is good for, if somebody's a million years ahead of us, let's say, is killing people. Well, take that to its logical conclusion. Either you learn to live at peace with your neighbors, anybody you can reach, local
galactic
neighbors.
So you think the aliens would be writing poetry and stuff, right?
No, I think they'd be protecting themselves. I think they would know about biology. They would live a long time. They'd know about computers. They would develop wisdom, something we seem to be sadly lacking.
You think the aliens would be smarter than us?
Yes, certainly more advanced, live a longer time, have more access to, say, millions of years of data. We're new.
We trust aliens more than we trust us, don't we?
Bud Hopkins, the best abduction researcher around, says there's two groups you can't trust when they say something, the aliens and the government. I think he was right.
All right, here's a more serious question. Why would the government be interested in covering up the existence of UFOs? Because my cousin Conway, for example, who I think you'd really like, by the way, if you ever met him, he tells me the stock market would crash, there'd be total anarchy, all kinds of stuff. But why? I don't get that. Why would that happen?
I think five major reasons. I'll keep them short. First, you want to figure out how the darn things work. They make wonderful weapons delivery and defense systems. Advanced technology, military, is where it's at. You set up your secret project. Rule number one for security is you can't tell your friends without telling your enemies. They watch television, too, after all. Second problem, the other side of the coin. What if the other guy, and every country has an other guy, figures out how they work before you do? How do you defend against them? You don't want them to know, you know, they know. The third problem is the big one, the political problem. If there were to be an announcement tomorrow by highly trusted individuals around the world, Walter Cronkite and the Pope, let's say, saying indeed some UFOs are alien spacecraft and they're neutral, let's say, what would happen? Church attendance would go up, mental hospital admissions would go up, stock market would go down, uncertainty is the enemy. But I think the biggest thing that would happen based on 600 college lectures is that the younger generation, which was never alive when there wasn't a space program, would immediately push for a new view of ourselves instead of as Americans, Canadians, Greeks, Chinese, Earthling. There's no government on this planet, of which I'm aware, that wants its citizens to owe their primary allegiance to the planet instead of the individual government. Nationalism's the only game in town. There's another problem. Certain fundamentalists, Jerry Falwell comes to mind, Pat Robertson, have loudly proclaimed, we're the only intelligent life in the universe. Let's hope they're wrong. And this is the work of the devil. And they'd be up the creek without a paddle if somebody made an announcement.
So it's that old question of if the alien shows up and says, take me to your leader, we don't really know who that is on Earth, right?
Yeah, we say land on the White House lawn.
In these movies, it's always the American president, right? But, you know, reasonably, it'd be like the Secretary General of the UN or something like that,
right? There's nobody who speaks for planet Earth. As a matter of fact, some of the Arab countries cut out parts of Independence Day.
The Pope. Send him to meet with the Pope.
There are some of us who might not agree with the Pope.
Well, I mean, he's got half of them. You know, it's like that's the best we can do. I just thought of something else I want to ask you, but let's watch some more of Mars Attacks featuring Natalie Portman, star of Star Wars Episode I. And I probably shouldn't even get you started on Star Wars, should I, Stan?
No.
We won't even go there. Roll the film. If the aliens do come, would you like to, you know, party with the aliens?
Take me to your leader, guys. Lead me to your taker is more like it when you consider the abduction cases.
back to Joe Bob Summer School and Mars Attacks on TNT.
You know, this is the second summer school movie to make excessive use of Chihuahua humor. Remember that Chihuahua in Hot Shots? Also the second movie to have a lot of Chihuahua abuse. Okay, we're talking to Stanton T. Friedman, nuclear physicist, UFO expert. And here's my question, Stan. If the government is so concerned about covering up the existence of UFOs, why does NASA have programs where they're looking for other life in the universe? If the life is here, why are we out there looking for it?
Well, NASA has abandoned the notion of listening for radio telescope signals. You know, SETI, S-E-T-I, which really stands for Silly Effort to Investigate.
That's because that Charlie Sheen movie came out about listening for those, and everyone hated it.
No, I think NASA has changed its tune entirely. They're getting a lot closer to home. They're looking for planets around nearby stars. They're looking for water on Europa, satellite in the solar system, for the history of Mars indicating there was water there. Whether it's water, we're talking about setting up a base on the moon where there is frozen water.
We just sent a camera up to Mars. It was all rocks, right?
Yeah, but there's an indication that in the past there was water there. And if that was the case, then there was probably life there. And the question is, what happened to the life? You know, did they have a war?
Oh, you think they're here?
No.
They left Mars and came here?
NASA has avoided dealing with flying saucers assiduously, I think, because the government said, thou shalt not. But if you're really interested in extraterrestrial intelligence, you look at the data, which is the flying saucer data, from all over the world, the radar visual, et cetera, cases. And who cares about radio telescopes? Then, you know, the silliest notion is that radio is the most advanced technology for long-distance communication. Would you have said smoke signals 150 years ago? Friedman's law. Technological progress comes from doing things differently in an unpredictable way. The future is not an extrapolation of the past. A laser isn't just a better light bulb, in other words. Different physics.
What technologies, then, would we need before we can do any serious space travel?
Nuclear fusion programs that I worked on in the early 60s. Fusion is what goes on in the sun. It's the most important source of energy in all our lives, after all. Without the sun, we're down the tubes pretty quick. If you use the right stuff in the right way and kick particles out the back end of a fusion rocket that have 10 million times as much energy per particle as you can get in a dumb old chemical rocket. So fusion would do it, but I think aliens are using techniques about which we know nothing because of the fact that technology progress comes from doing things differently. Look, there's stars in our neighborhood a billion years older than we are.
You're starting to scare me, Stan. And you know why? Because I'm starting to believe you. Okay.
Why is that scary?
You think we'll ever find anybody out there like us or I mean, you think they've got karaoke bars in outer space and I Love Lucy and everything, or just like with eyes in them walking around?
No, I think there are humanoids. All the stories indicate humanoids. I think they've gone through the karaoke stage some time back. Sorry.
But they look like us, huh?
Two arms, two legs, a head, and a body. In any place but New York, you'd say, hey, they're different. In New York, you wouldn't pay any attention.
Would they listen to Backstreet Boys?
Who knows what their musical
tastes
are.
Or would they shoot them?
I don't think shoot first, answer questions later is their approach.
Thanks for coming by. It's been very educational. And we're going to go back to Mars Attacks now. But I really appreciate it, Stan. This has been great. Let me give you some advice. Don't take any titanium monetary units.
Okay.
I don't know what that means.
Joe Bob, I saw this movie in 1984, and it had a girl in it, and she's sitting by this tree. What movie was that? People, we have got to have more information than that when you're submitting something for the Find That Flick contest. Now, normally, if you give me a plot description, I will know the title of the movie you're trying to remember. But if I can't answer it, hundreds of my fellow drive-in mutants can, because I got fans that watch 32 movies a day. They never leave their apartments. So to find out how to play and all the free junk you can win, visit the MonsterVision website at tnt.turner.com/MonsterVision and look for the Find That Flick contest. Joe Bob, I saw this movie with a talking bear in it and Morgan Fairchild naked. See, that's a description I can work with.
Visit the MonsterVision website at tnt.turner.com/MonsterVision. Back to Joe Bob Summer School and Mars Attacks on TNT.
That's one of my favorite scenes from this flick, the one where Martin Short brings the alien hooker into the White House and shows her a good time. That was the fine-looking Lisa Marie as the alien, and Lisa is Tim Burton's girlfriend, but she does have a career of her own. In fact, she was in a movie I saw on cable the other night called Breast Men. about these two guys who invented the silicone implant, and Lisa Marie and many other fine actresses were flashing their talents all over the place in that thing. Excellent flick. I would recommend it. Anyway, I was thinking as I watched that last scene that there's one thing that never changes about alien invasion movies. They did it in 1953, and they have it today. Ray guns. The ray guns get fancier and fancier, but they're still ray guns, right? And have we ever actually had evidence that ray guns exist anywhere? I don't think so. It's something learned completely from the movies, right? We just keep doing it over and over. Don't you think that's interesting? Guess not. Mildly interesting. Okay, back to the movie. Ray guns, laser swords, you know, same thing. Anything that's just basically aiming a blast of deadly light at somebody. Laser pointers, cheap special effects. The patriotic laser light show at Six Flags. You know, now that is deadly. Okay, you screwed up again, didn't you? It's your fifth year in junior college. Your life has no possibility of improving. Not true if you attend yet another session of Joe Bob's Summer School. 9 brain-expanding Saturday nights good for actual credit at Southern Arizona State Community College at Ajo. But you need to enroll your hiney. To register, you got to go to the summer school website and get a syllabus. Plus, you'll be able to see who some of our guest lecturers are this summer. And you'll also get a sneak peek at a few of the final exam questions. And you can even include yourself in our summer yearbook, listing your worst subject and favorite hobbies. The internet address for Joe Bob's Summer School is tnt.turner.com/summerschool. That doesn't mean you can skip the dang class. Of course, even academic probation is fun at Joe Bob Summer School, Saturday nights on Turner National Technical Institute.
Visit Joe Bob Summer School at tnt.turner.com/summerschool. Back to Joe Bob Summer School and Mars Attacks on TNT.
So, class, that was the great Tom Jones wailing away on It's Not Unusual, and the movie that just gets goofier and goofier, doesn't it? Mars Attacks. This is a very busy movie, isn't it? Kind of gives you a headache. And speaking of sex symbols, and if you don't think Tom Jones is a sex symbol, just talk to my mama. He is. It's time to read a little viewer mail in what we call Professor Joe Bob's Advice to the Hopeless. And here to help us out is my favorite teacher's aide, Rusty, the campus mail girl. You believe in UFOs, Rusty?
Isn't that kind of like asking me if I believe in God?
I don't follow that.
Well, I've never seen a UFO, but that doesn't mean I can say that they don't exist.
So you believe there could be UFOs?
I'm not saying there are, but I'm not saying there aren't.
Did you ever see anything suspicious up in the sky when you were flying for the Air Force? Because I know you did that.
Here's a letter from Rusty Shorts. It's from Wabasa, Minnesota.
It's classified information, isn't it? Dear Joe Bob, before I started watching Joe Bob Briggs' Monster Vision show, I could not speak a word of English. The only language I knew was Minnesotan. I sounded like Mr. Tudfall on the Carol Burnett Show. You have given me new hope. You are the Pavarotti of the spoken word, the Dr. Ruth of thesaurusness, the tundra of truthfulness, the troglodyte of veracity. Thank you, Joe Bob. Sincerely yours, Eastern European, British Isles American, Rusty Shorts. Isn't that cute? P.S. This paper is made from recycled boogers from a leper colony. Don't worry, you won't catch anything unless you pick it up with both hands at the same time. That's very funny, Rusty Short. You know, normally we have to pay a nickel each for jokes like that, Rusty. Here, why don't you take this with you when you go, all right?
No, thank you.
Wait, you have to tell me, what did you see up there?
I didn't say I saw anything.
Okay, but if you did see something, what might it have been, speaking hypothetically? I have a picture of you shaking hands with a 3-foot-tall purple man.
How'd you get that?
I was bluffing.
Oh, I was too.
First, there was my TNT Monster Vision website with the famous caption contest, which is still going strong, I might add. Then we added the incredibly sexy Monster Vision t-shirt, coveted by would-be prize winners everywhere. Then we added the Find That Flick contest, in which you can win all kinds of free junk just by knowing the plots of weird movies. And now we proudly present Joe Bob's Summer School website, which is the perfect companion to my summer-long movie lineup on TNT. Well, not the perfect companion. Jennifer Lopez would be the perfect companion. But my point is, I'm slowly building an empire here at TNT. It's no longer possible to take me lightly, and I'll take just as much time as I want with this promo. Okay, to find out your class assignments and guest lecturers, get on the information superhighway and drive to tnt.turner.com/summerschool. And
enroll at Joe Bob Summer School now at tnt.turner.com/summerschool. Back to Joe Bob Summer School and Mars Attacks on TNT.
I'll be calling you. Indian love call. I could kill some aliens, couldn't I? Grandma's answer to the Martian invasion. And since it was only 10 seconds since the last commercial break, let's get right back to it, okay? You know what movie Tim Burton watched right before he made this? I guarantee you. It's a mad, 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 mad world, don't you think? I'll be loving you.
Back to Joe Bob Summer School and Mars Attacks on TNT.
That's Pam Grier, pre-Jackie Brown, and fellow blaxploitation star Jim Brown as Byron, giving the Martians the old left hook. Did you guys know that Pam Grier dated Richard Pryor and Kareem Abdul-Jabbar? In fact, Kareem even proposed to her right after he became a follower of Islam. He called her from his mosque and popped the question on the phone. And Pam said she hadn't had enough time to embrace his religion. She was a little worried about it. So Kareem says, well, if you don't commit to me today, I'm going to get married this afternoon to a Muslim woman who's already been prepared for me. That's gotta hurt, right? Okay, let's get back to the movie. Wonder how that Muslim woman was prepared for Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, you know? Sounds interesting, doesn't it? Is there like a menu for that? Or...
And now, Joe Bob Summer School and Forbidden Planet on TNT.
There were just too many famous people to talk about in that movie. Sylvia Sidney, the 30s glamour girl, she was the crazy grandma. The French president was director Barbette Schroeder. Even the waiter who brought Natalie Portman the pizza was a novelist named Julian Barnes. I think Tim Burton maybe should have spent a little less time on casting cameos and a little more on some momentum for the story. But his movies never pay too much attention to story anyway, now that I think about it. Jerzy Skolimowski, he's in the movie. He played Dr. Ziegler. You guys know who Jerzy Skolimowski is? Only the greatest director in Poland. Oh, yeah. Thank you very much. All right. I want to let you know that next week, Joe Bob's Summer School is going on a special field trip for Food Science 504. You're not going to believe this one. But we're going to the world-famous restaurant Spago in Beverly Hills, California, where the one and only Wolfgang Puck is going to teach me how to cook. And we'll be watching the classic Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory and the Clint Howard gross-out horror flick The Ice Cream Man, and Clint Howard himself will be here. And speaking of yummy, our next movie is the 1956 cult favorite that stars Anne Francis in many leg-bearing futuristic mini-dresses. Anne Francis may have invented the mini-dress, now that I think about that. You didn't have many girls dressed like this in the 50s. I'm talking about, of course, Forbidden Planet, and Anne will be joining us in a little while to give us all the dirt on Leslie Nielsen and Robbie the Robot. The movie takes place in 2200 AD when Nielsen and a crew of whiskey-loving, horny astronauts land on a planet where the only survivor of a previous colonization is Walter Pigeon and his luscious virginal daughter, who doesn't mind making out with crew members in the bushes, even though an invisible monster is tearing people to shreds. Let's do those drive-in totals. We have 7 dead bodies, 1 dead tiger, 2 naked Butox, female this time, brain boosting, door melting, gratuitous underground tour, electron foo, and we're showing it in letterbox format because it was shot in widescreen cinemascope, so I hope your TV's not as dinky as mine is. It's a pretty cool movie. I give it 3.5 stars, subtracting a half star only for those scenes without Anne Francis in them. Check it out. And like I said, Anne will be joining us in just a little bit. That naked Butox count, that's been going up lately. Have you noticed that? You guys seen that? This is like the 4th set of Butox we've had in summer school alone. I think that TNT Butox patrol in Atlanta has loosened up a little bit, you know?
And now, Joe Bob Summer School and Forbidden Planet on TNT.
There were just too many famous people to talk about in that movie. Sylvia Sidney, the 30s glamour girl, she was the crazy grandma. The French president was director Barbette Schroeder. Even the waiter who brought Natalie Portman the pizza was a novelist named Julian Barnes. I think Tim Burton maybe should have spent a little less time on casting cameos and a little more on some momentum for the story, but his movies never pay too much attention to story anyway, now that I think about it. Jerzy Skolimowski, he's in the movie. He played Dr. Ziegler. You guys know who Jerzy Skolimowski is?
No.
Only the greatest director in Poland.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you very much. All right. I want to let you know that next week, Joe Bob's Summer School is going on a special field trip for Food Science 504. You're not going to believe this one. But we're going to the world-famous restaurant Spago in Beverly Hills, California, where the one and only Wolfgang Puck is going to teach me how to cook. And we'll be watching the classic Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory and the Clint Howard gross-out horror flick, The Ice Cream Man. And Clint Howard himself will be here. And speaking of yummy, our next movie is the 1956 cult favorite that stars Anne Francis in many leg-bearing futuristic mini-dresses. Anne Francis may have invented the mini-dress, now that I think about that. You didn't have many girls dressed like this in the 50s. I'm talking about, of course, Forbidden Planet, and Anne will be joining us in a little while to give us all the dirt on Leslie Nielsen and Robbie the Robot. The movie takes place in 2200 AD when Nielsen and a crew of whiskey-loving, horny astronauts land on a planet where the only survivor of a previous colonization is Walter Pigeon and his luscious virginal daughter, who doesn't mind making out with crew members in the bushes, even though an invisible monster is tearing people to shreds. Let's do those drive-in totals. We have 7 dead bodies, 1 dead tiger, 2 naked buttox, female this time, brain boosting, door melting, gratuitous underground tour, electron foo, and we're showing it in letterbox format because it was shot in widescreen cinemascope, so I hope your TV's not as dinky as mine is. It's a pretty cool movie. I give it 3.5 stars, subtracting a half star only for those scenes without Anne Francis in them. Check it out. And like I said, Anne will be joining us in just a little bit. That naked buttock count, that's been going up lately. Have you noticed that? You guys seen that? This is like the 4th set of buttocks we've had in summer school alone. I think that TNT buttock patrol in Atlanta has loosened up a little bit, you know? Okay, you screwed up again, didn't you? It's your 5th year in junior college. Your life has no possibility of improving. Not true if you attend yet another session of Joe Bob's Summer School. 9 brain-expanding Saturday nights good for actual credit at Southern Arizona State Community College at Ajo. But you need to enroll your hiney. To register, you got to go to the summer school website and get a syllabus. Plus, you'll be able to see who some of our guest lecturers are this summer. And you'll also get a sneak peek at a few of the final exam questions. And you can even include yourself in our summer yearbook, listing your worst subject and favorite hobbies. The internet address for Joe Bob's Summer School is tnt.turner.com/summerschool. That doesn't mean you can skip the dang class. Of course, even academic probation is fun at Joe Bob Summer School, Saturday nights on Turner National Technical Institute.
Visit Joe Bob Summer School at tnt.turner.com/summerschool. Back to Joe Bob Summer School and Forbidden Planet on TNT.
The famous Robbie the Robot, which caused a sensation back in 1956. We tried to find Robbie and have him on the show, but we think he's been bought by some Japanese guys. Because my friend Mick Garris, the director of many Stephen King films, directed The Stand, he used to own Robbie and keep him in good working condition. And, well, he never really was in very good working condition. I think they kind of shoved him around from inside somewhere in Robbie. But Mick sold Robbie, and we can't... Oh, we have him? We have Robbie? All right, I'm going to talk to him at the break. We may have Robbie here. Anyhow, that's Leslie Nielsen as the commander. You know, Leslie's now a household name for the Naked Gun movies, but you notice that he acts the same in these early serious movies as in Naked Gun? You just change the writing a little bit, and suddenly he's doing comedy. But he never really changed. Okay, I don't want to kill too much time here because we got Anne Francis coming out at the next break, so roll film. And by the way, who here knows what a philologist is? I'll give you a hint. A philologist would know what a philologist is. Of course, if the philologist wasn't called a philologist, if it was called something equally complex, would the philologist still know what a philologist is? Yes, they would. Or would a philologist by any other name still be a philologist? I don't know. Okay, I'll tell you. A philologist is an expert in philology. First, there was my TNT MonsterVision website with the famous caption contest, which is still going strong, I might add. Then we added the incredibly sexy MonsterVision t-shirt, coveted by would-be prize winners everywhere. Then we added the Find That Flick contest, in which you can win all kinds of free junk just by knowing the plots of weird movies. And now we proudly present Joe Bob's Summer School website, which is the perfect companion to my summer-long movie lineup on TNT. Well, not the perfect companion. Jennifer Lopez would be the perfect companion. But my point is, I'm slowly building an empire here at TNT. It's no longer possible to take me lightly, and I'll take just as much time as I want with this promo. Okay, to find out your class assignments and guest lecturers, get on the information superhighway and drive to tnt.turner.com/summerschool and...
Enroll at Joe Bob Summer School now at tnt.turner.com/summerschool. Back to Joe Bob Summer School and Forbidden Planet on TNT.
The words we've all been waiting for, Father. Did I do that right? The first words of Anne Frances as Altera Morbius, the lust-inspiring daughter of Walter Pidgeon. And this is where the movie gets really interesting. And this room also just got interesting because live in person with us tonight is the cult heartthrob herself, Anne Frances. So, welcome, Anne. I know I did that first line terrible. It's sort of...
No, it's more, Father.
Yes, okay.
Father.
And that famous dress you're wearing, what kind of planning went into that dress?
That was planning, studio planning.
Yes?
Yes.
And what were they
yes.
going for
but
there?
But they had one outfit that Dory Sherry's wife, Virginia Sherry, wouldn't allow us to use because she said it was too sexy.
You mean they were going for... There was a more revealing outfit that we didn't get to see?
No. Oh, okay. It was silver from the neck all the way down. It was just... It was sort of like a silver lamé all the way down with silver boots. And then there was a silver hood that came... Everything was completely covered.
But she thought
and then
it was
over
too
that was a coat that was see-through plastic coat. And silver gloves,
and
too
so
sexy.
They thought that was too sexy, and they went for the shortest mini dress in the history of motion pictures yeah. up to that time.
Yeah.
Did you ever wear that dress in public?
No.
Like to a promotional event or anything?
No, they wouldn't have let it out of the studio.
Okay, I got to ask you this.
What?
Were you really madly in love with Leslie Nielsen?
Of course.
Yeah?
Sure, why not?
Did you have
he was gorgeous.
A hot love affair with Leslie
course,
on the
of
set?
Of course, I thought he was fabulous.
Yeah?
And I was madly in love with him before I met him because I'd seen him do wonderful, wonderful work on live television, you know, back in the days when, which I had come from before I came out to the
Are you
the
still
studios.
Good friends today?
Sure, haven't seen him for quite a while, but we've done a couple of shows since then together.
Yeah.
Great guy.
Well, this was your very first role. And, of course, among your most famous roles. But you're really also well-known for a particular Twilight Zone episode. Do many people ask you about that? I'm sure they do.
We go from Father to Marcia.
And it's the one where you're a mannequin.
After Hours, yes.
Who comes
to the mannequin who comes to life and doesn't remember that she's a mannequin and goes to the store to buy a gold thimble for her mother. And then she gets... embroiled in a horrific experience of being on the 13th floor and
the beautiful mannequin
kind of like this.
Well, the beautiful mannequin who comes to life is kind of an evergreen story that's been used many times in the movies and always takes like they take the most gorgeous girl in Hollywood at the time and do the mannequin story.
Oh, you're
We'll talk more with our special guest lecturer Anne Frances at the next break, but let's get back to Forbidden Planet. And whatever happened to that Anne Frances mannequin, by the way?
Frances mannequin?
The Anne Frances mannequin in the Twilight Zone episode.
Oh, my gosh, you had me going for a second there.
No. There was an Anne Frances mannequin in the Twilight Zone episodes. You know, it's probably a collector's item today, right?
Well, I have the head that was originally done.
You have the head?
Yes, it's sitting on top of my dresser in my bedroom.
Oh,
But
well, you
know,
don't want something like that
hit.
Getting into the wrong hands. I'm glad that you have it.
I sprayed
you know,
it gold.
Well, you know what? You could put it in
your
car. I
should put a mirror around it.
No, you could put it in your car and use the carpool lane.
You're right. That's a good idea. I will put it on a. That's a
Twin
great
sisters.
Idea. Great idea.
Want to win a free video of some obscure horror movie you've never heard of that some guy in West Virginia made in his basement? Of course you do. That's why umpteen jillion people have discovered our Find That Flick contest. If you've never heard of it, forget it. It's too complicated to explain on TV. But you can find out all about it on our MonsterVision website at tnt.turner.com/MonsterVision. And I'll give you one clue. If you're one of those guys who never leaves his apartment except to rent videos, this contest was designed to give heretofore unrealized meaning to your life.
Play the Find That Flick contest at tnt.turner.com/MonsterVision. Back to Joe Bob Summer School and Forbidden Planet on TNT.
Well, we're seeing more and more of why Anne Francis is so popular in this movie, because there you were making out with Jack Kelly, probably best known as Bart Maverick.
Yep.
And by the way, Anne, since this is UFO Studies 666 tonight, that's our topic, I want to ask you, do you believe in any kind of other life out there?
No, I'm just getting over 666, that number.
It was a little joke we made about UFO studies, you know.
I see. Do I believe there's any life out there?
Yeah.
Well, I've seen things out there, but then you know me. I can see things, you know. Well, you remember when they had all of that big hullabaloo about Phoenix, Arizona, and the flaming lights in the sky? I've seen that out over Palm Desert, where I live, up when I've been up in the mountains, up in Pinyon Crest, I've seen that, and I've seen one silver disc out there. So yeah, something's going on.
Well, you actually had an eerie experience with some kind of ghost, right, when your daughter was little. What was that about?
That has absolutely nothing at all to do with Forbidden Planet.
Well, we've done a little research. We want to ask you about other things,
Anne. It's too long and too involved to tell you, Joe Bob.
All right. But you have daughters, right?
I have two wonderful daughters.
Are they
both healthy?
Yeah?
And well.
Are they as good looking as you?
They're gorgeous.
Yeah? All right. Well, let's talk about... By the way, I wanted to refresh your memory. Here's the mannequin. Starlog magazine.
Yes.
Here's the mannequin. You'd forgotten about this mannequin.
I hadn't forgotten about that mannequin, but when you said the Anne Francis mannequin, that's a Marcia mannequin.
Oh, okay.
There's a difference.
And also, here's that silver lame jumpsuit that was regarded as too sexy for Forbidden Planet. All right, let's talk about your TV show, Honey West, for a minute. It was on in 1965, and one of the things I remember is that your lace garter belt was a gas mask.
Now, there you're wrong. Somebody
told
you that because I never had a lace garter belt that was a gas mask, so there.
Really?
Never. Who gave you that
false? I saw the episode
where
you...
That's Debbie. She gave you false information.
No.
She read the books instead of watching the show. I would never have had a garter belt that was a gas mask.
Well, you had all kinds of gadgets on the show, right?
Yeah, but
you... Anne, work with me a little bit, okay?
Not when you
say
these things.
Well, describe the character for me then. I'll just listen.
She was fun-loving. She was adventurous. She was a lady detective. She had a marvelous time. All the bad guys she, you know, would kick in the butt. And all the good guys she'd save. And she knew karate. She had an ocelot cat named Bruce. Bit of trivia.
Everyone
there.
Remembers the ocelot. No, that's not trivia. That's
well,
a major
Well, the name
part of the
Bruce
show.
Is trivia because nobody remembers his name.
Bruce the ocelot. And the network canceled the show.
And he had a stand-in.
Yeah. And the network canceled the show after only one season because they could buy the rights to the Avengers for
they could
less
get the
than
Avengers.
It cost to make the show.
Yeah.
But people still talk about the show. And isn't it back on one
it's
of
on
the...
It's on TV Land. Well, you don't want to talk TV about
Land.
TV Land.
Okay.
I don't think.
One of the cable networks. Okay, we're going to see what new dress Robbie the Robot makes for Anne as we continue with Forbidden Planet. Didn't you name your dog after Walter Pigeon? Don't tell me that's not true.
Walter Smidgen was his name.
Walter Smidgen,
and
okay.
I was down in Palm Springs visiting with Smidge along with me, and somebody who thought they were being very cute said that I was visiting so-and-so at such-and-such place in Palm Springs with Walter Pigeon.
Oh.
That caused quite a stir, especially with Mrs. Pigeon.
Did you like Walter?
You're very nosy, aren't you?
Was he?
I did not have an affair with Walter Pigeon. No.
He played my father.
Remember?
Well, I know, but it would have been difficult to have an affair with Walter Pigeon while you were having an affair with Leslie Nielsen.
I know, and then there was Jack Kelly too.
Making out with him.
Oh, sure.
Anyway, but you named your dog Walter Smidgen. That could be considered a tribute, or it could be considered, you know.
Well, Smidgen was his name, and I chose Walter for his first name for obvious reasons. I thought it was funny.
I do know.
But
a woman...
now that I look back, it wasn't.
I know a woman who calls her dog Joe Bob, and I know several women who call Joe Bob a dog, but we won't go into that.
Back to Joe Bob Summer School and Forbidden Planet on TNT.
Something sabotaged the klystron generator, not to mention the gyro stabilizer. What was all that stuff, Ann? Do you remember? All that techno jargon. What was all that about?
That was all wonderful stuff that was in the script, Joe Bob.
Okay, a Rod Serling script, by the way. Professor Joe Bob here.
No, it wasn't.
Rod Serling and someone else, right?
Rod Serling? No, Rod Serling did not. It was Cyril Hume who wrote the script.
What? Planet of the Apes. I'm sorry, I'm getting all my movies mixed up this summer on Joe Bob's Summer School. Professor Joe Bob here with Anne Francis, who plays Altera in Forbidden Planet. Anne, you are such a flirt in this movie.
Yes.
Were you naked in that lagoon?
Of course not.
Okay, I don't mean to offend you. You look naked. They made you look naked. They did a good job.
But if you look fast as I'm coming out of the lagoon, you can see a wisp of pale, sort of pinkish chiffon in the breeze. Quick! You have to look quickly.
Okay. How was it working with the robot, Robbie the robot?
Oh, Robbie was wonderful.
I hear he got really drunk.
Oh, you know something? You just are full of stories, aren't you? You're just full of all kinds
of information. Now, come on, this is a famous story.
It became famous when I opened my mouth and told it once, and from then on it's just become...
Robbie the robot got drunk,
right? There were two different guys who worked inside Robbie the robot, because working inside Robbie the robot, in defense of this one fellow, it was a very tough job. It was hot inside there. It was really rough. And this one day, he had a couple of martinis for lunch. And when he got back in the suit, there's a scene, you know, where Robbie walks away from this the big kind of Jeep van kind of thing that he's attached to. Mm-hmm. And when he was walking away, something happened, and his feet kind of went like this, like on an incline, and he started going this way, downward. And about 15 grips got him before he hit the ground, because he was the most expensive actor in the show. He cost $1 million to put together. That was important stuff.
So that was the...
A drunken actor you can replace.
But the guy almost
ruined... A robot you can't replace.
Ruined the robot suit.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
Let's go back to the movie, because that was a really short segment. We'll talk again at the next segment. How many times have you actually watched this movie?
Do you know, I haven't really watched it that often, but I just saw it at the Los Angeles Theater a couple of weeks ago on CinemaScope. We had 2,100 people there. We had the greatest time. Yeah,
and
it was fun.
Did you remembered it? Do you know it by heart?
Yeah, pretty much so.
Okay, then which is it, the klystron generator or the klystron transmitter?
Oh, no, that part I didn't have to memorize, Joe Bob. That part was not my responsibility.
Okay. When you enter the caption contest and you don't win, do not write us a letter saying his caption sucks. Let's be good sports about this, okay? After all, the only reason you're so angry is that the stakes are so low. One measly MonsterVision t-shirt. Because if the prize is that cheap and you don't win it, it kind of brings into question your potential in all areas, right? But let's not dwell on that. If you think your caption is hilarious, then come on down to the website and try to make the six-headed jury laugh. That address is tnt.turner.com/MonsterVision. And here's a tip. Think sixth grade humor. We love that.
Try to win a free t-shirt in our caption contest on the one and only MonsterVision website at tnt.turner.com/MonsterVision. Back to Joe Bob Summer School and Forbidden Planet on TNT.
Wow, this is a talky movie, you know? Do they have to give the whole history of Krell civilization? Anyway, we have a special treat for our guest lecturer, Ann Francis. So let me give a little history about Robbie the Robot. I want to get this out of the way first before we do our special presentation. But Robbie was such a hit in Forbidden Planet in 1956 that he did another movie the following year called The Invisible Boy. And he also appeared in many TV shows throughout the years, including Lost in Space and The Twilight Zone and even The Love Boat. And in 1970, MGM sold Robbie the Robot at an auction to a prop museum, where he proceeded to get vandalized over time by these wrongdoing hoodlums. And then in 1974, Robbie was restored by a guy named Fred Barton. And sometime after that, my pal Mick Garris, the director of The Stand, bought Robbie and put him in his house, I think. And then Mick then sold Robbie to Bill Malone, another director who just directed the remake of House on Haunted Hill. And then we think that Bill sold him to some kind of Japanese touring sci-fi exhibit. But guess who has the licensing rights to Robbie? Who bought all the old MGM films a few years ago? Ted Turner, right? So Turner Entertainment has the rights to Robbie the Robot, and we used our pull to arrange for a very special reunion tonight. Ann Francis, your old friend, Robbie the Robot. How about this? Robbie the Robot, what do you think? She's so happy, she doesn't know what to say. Robbie, they're just like you remember him, right? And we spent a lot of money getting him here, so I hope it was worth it.
I think he's been using the Thigh Master. He's hey. A little thinner down here than I remember.
Okay, what's going on? You couldn't get the robot, right? I asked for the robot so many times that you told me you had the robot. It's one of those Time Warner bureaucracy things, right? We have the rights to the robot. Ann, I'm so embarrassed.
I know, but don't get upset. It's all right. It's a nice robot. What, you know, don't hurt its feelings.
You try to cover it up with this. You don't know the kind of people
Frankie.
I work for here.
He's beautiful. I don't know
robot,
why
he's not that tall, is he? Robbie the Robot is about six feet, you know?
Robbie's about this tall, and he did not have black rubber gloves. God knows what they're for.
Don't you dum-dums know that? Good grief. I'm sorry,
that's
Ann,
right.
But thanks
that's
so much
right.
for coming by. Let's get back to the movie. And it's humiliating to do that kind of thing to me. The gorgeous Ann Francis, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you.
Thank you. It's been
Are you
fun.
Single, Ann?
Yeah.
Oh.
So,
still
available. What does that mean?
Just had to find out before
you leave.
Okay, fire away. I can take it. Hit me with your best shot. You're going to reduce me to tears, aren't you? You're going to emasculate me with your mail, as usual. But if you got something to say about tonight's movie, or me, or the mail girl, or the war in Kosovo, then I invite you, because I am a masochist, to contact me at my personal email address, monstervision@turner.com, or you can visit the MonsterVision website at tnt.turner.com/monstervision and send a crushing, mean-spirited email from there. Or you can even do it the old-fashioned way by sending a letter to MonsterVision, care of TNT Programming, 1010 Techwood Drive, Atlanta, Georgia, 30318. So I've given you three ways to nuke me. I would remind you, God is watching what you write.
Visit the MonsterVision website at tnt.turner.com/monstervision. Back to Joe Bob Summer School and Forbidden Planet on TNT.
Most Forbidden Planet fans would know that the movie is based on Shakespeare's play, The Tempest. You guys all knew that, right? It's based on The Tempest. Dr. Morbius, he's Prospero, the magician who controls the action in the play. Altera is his daughter Miranda in Shakespeare. Commander Adams, Leslie Nielsen's role, he's Prince Ferdinand in the play. Robbie the Robot is Caliban, the earthly spirit. The monster is Ariel. And I won't say why that's the monster, because that'll, you know, give away the ending of the movie. Oh, no! I ruined it, didn't I? You know the ending now, because I told you that Ariel is the monster. It's the same as The Tempest. Leon is over here bawling like a baby, because I ruined the surprise. Even the minor characters in the movie are based on the play, like the cook with a taste for the sauce. He matches Stefano, the drunken servant, in The Tempest. So, and that's the veteran actor Earl Holliman in that role, best known as Angie Dickinson's sidekick on Policewoman and many movies, Sharky's Machine. He was also in the original Twilight Zone episode, the one where he wanders around a deserted city the whole time, and then you find out he's part of a test to see how humans respond to being alone in spaceflight. The original Twilight Zone. Anybody who was anybody in those days got to do a Twilight Zone. Okay, let's keep it going. Back to the movie. Forbidden Planet is actually, it's actually based on Shakespeare's play and Freud's concept of a tripartite psyche. Would you like me to explain the tripartite psyche? I didn't think so.
Back to Joe Bob Summer School and Forbidden Planet on TNT.
What a great way to save special effects money. The creature is invisible. It's a giant four-footed arboreal killer sloth, right? But you can't see it. So, genius. But it's no wonder the crew of the spaceship couldn't kill the monster because they're only hitting it with 3 billion electron volts. That is a minuscule amount, like subatomic physics kind of minuscule. 3 billion of them wouldn't be enough to cook a snail. You hit a grain of sand with 3 billion electron volts, you don't even see a difference. All right, time for the exciting Shakespearean slash Freudian conclusion to Forbidden Planet. Go. 3 billion electron volts. I need that much just to do this. Watch. Is my left eyebrow moving? See, I need more than 3 billion. Guess I need, all right, full power. You know what that was? That was about 100 trillion electron volts.
Back to Joe Bob Summer School and Forbidden Planet on TNT.
Well, that was a little confusing there at the end, wasn't it? The Krell used an underground power plant to create little Princess Leia holograms, but they forgot about their own lust for destruction, the monsters of the id, which don't like strange men talking to daddy's little girl, do they? See, not only does this movie employ Freud's concept of the tripartite psyche, the id, the ego, and the superego, it also utilizes the archetypal Electra pattern, the female equivalent of Oedipus, or in layman's terms, it's that incest thing. And speaking of the Princess Leia hologram, this movie no doubt is where George Lucas got the idea for that scene in Star Wars. Because when he was creating Star Wars, he watched tons of old sci-fi flicks, including Forbidden Planet. And you can also trace R2-D2 and C-3PO back to Robbie the Robot. And would somebody get rid of this thing while I'm talking about Robbie the Robot? Anyhow, I want to thank Stanton T. Friedman and Ann Francis for stopping by tonight. Also, let me remind you that next week's summer school course is Food Science 504, and we'll be taking a field trip to the famous Spago in Beverly Hills so Wolfgang Puck can teach me how to take something out of the oven while it's still edible. And we'll be watching the food classics Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory and the Ice Cream Man, and Clint Howard will be dropping by, too. So that's it for me, Professor Joe Bob, wondering, if a tree falls in the forest and no one's there to see it, do the other trees make fun of it? Did you guys hear the one about this guy, Jake? This guy, Jake, is struggling through a bus station with these two huge suitcases when a stranger walks up to him and says, have you got the time? So Jake puts down the two suitcases and he looks at his wrist and he tells the stranger, it's 5:45. And the stranger says, hey, that's a pretty fancy watch. And Jake brightens up just a little bit and says, yeah, it's not bad. Check this out. And he shows him a time zone display, not just for every time zone in the world, but for the 86 largest cities in the world. He hits a few buttons on his watch, and from somewhere on the watch, this voice says, the time is 5:55. But it says it in a West Texas accent. Then a few more buttons, and the same voice says something in Japanese. And Jake says to the guy, yeah, I put in regional accents for each city on my watch. And the display on the watch is unbelievable high quality. The voice is amazing. The stranger, he's dumbstruck. And Jake says, well, that's not all if you really want to see the watch. And he pushes a few more buttons and this tiny but very high resolution map of New York City appears on the display. And he tells the guy, the flashing dot, see, shows our location by satellite positioning. And then he says, view recede 10. And the display changes to show Eastern New York State. Well, the stranger tells him, I want to buy this watch. And Jake says, oh, no, it's not ready for sale yet. I'm still working out all the bugs in it. But look at this. And he demonstrates that the watch is also a pretty decent little FM radio receiver with a digital tuner, and it has a sonar device on it that can measure distances up to 125 meters, a pager with thermal paper printout, and most impressive of all, the capacity for voice recordings of up to 300 standard-sized books. And he says, but I only have 32 of my favorites in there so far, you know, Jake tells me. The stranger says, I got to have this watch. And Jake says, no, you don't understand. It's not ready. And the stranger says, I'll give you $1,000 for the watch. And Jake says, oh, no, I've already spent more than that developing the watch. And he says, I'll give you $5,000 for it. And Jake goes, oh, but it's just not. He says, I'll give you $15,000 for this watch. The stranger pulls out his checkbook, and Jake thinks about it a minute, and he's only invested about $8,500 in materials and development. With $15,000, he can make another watch and have it ready for merchandising in 6 months or so. So the stranger frantically finishes writing out the check, and he waves it in front of him, and he says, here it is, and I'm ready to hand it to you right now, $15,000. Take it or leave it. And Jake says, Okay, and he peels off the watch, and they make the exchange, and the stranger starts away happily with his new watch, and Jake calls out to him, "Hey, wait a minute." And he turns around, the stranger turns around and looks at him, and Jake points to the two suitcases he'd been trying to wrestle through the bus station. He says, "Don't forget your batteries." Joe Bob Briggs reminding you that the drive-in will never die. That was a long mother of a joke, wasn't it? Okay, a black guy, a white guy, a Catholic priest, a Lutheran minister, a rabbi, a hooker, a chicken, a football player, a baseball player, a wife, a husband, a Pole, a Russian, a little boy, a dog, a drunk, an Irishman, St. Peter, and a penguin walk into a bar. Bartender says, "What is this, a joke?" Two peanuts are walking down the street. One is assaulted.